This is WCIU-TV, Channel 26, Chicago's first ultra-high-frequency television station, beginning another day of broadcasting. WCIU-TV, Channel 26, is owned and operated by the Weigel Broadcasting Company and transmits on a frequency of 542 megacycles as authorized by the Federal Communications Commission. Studios and transmitter are located in the Board of Trade Building in Chicago. Channel 26 is dedicated to serving all the people of the Chicago area. Portions of today's program are mechanically reproduced. And now keep your dial set on Channel 26 for the finest of television programming.
Good morning. We're speaking to you from the top of the Board of Trade Building overlooking LaSalle Street in downtown Chicago, the dynamic center of business, industry, and finance for the Midwest. Here, Channel 26 has established the financial news headquarters with the Stock Market Observer. You are that observer, and you'll see the fascinating story of the nation's economy today unfolding before your eyes. Services of the world's largest financial news statistics computer inform you, and through the words of your host, Ben Larson.
Who's happy to bid you a very pleasant good morning? This is Friday, October 22nd, 1971. Our program early this a.m. at 8:30 is called Market Reprise. Market Reprise, a summary of the important facts and figures in the world of finance. I'm going to talk about some of the significant numbers to prepare you for today's coverage on our Stock Market Observer program. This information brought to you through the courtesy of the friendly folks at U.S. Steel. Wow. Let's set the scene here, if we may, first of all, by taking a look at our graph at what transpired yesterday. Now, you know that over about the past seven sessions, we've lost around 40 points with the Dow Industrials. You've heard that old phrase that the market hates uncertainty. Still, some people in doubt as to what phase two of the president's economic game plan is all about. Well, we've had nothing but down markets and for quite a few sessions until this faint glimmer of hope that occurred about 1:30 Chicago time yesterday. We were down well over 4 points throughout most of the session. And then there was a remarkable turnaround, and we started coming back very rapidly and strongly with the Dow Industrial Average, so that when we were off at the close here, we were off very slightly. Let's move down to our Dow board now. Notice that the Dow Jones Industrial Average was off by 0.80, but remember, it'd been off well over four. Transportation Average, on the other hand, closed on the plus side by 0.82. Utilities were up by 0.03. Unfortunately, we do not have a closing tick because we had a cable cut yesterday, and a great deal of our information did not make it to our studios. Our volume yesterday, very close to that 15 million mark. Let's move along now across our Quotron boards, which again did not post, to our, what were our trading statistics. I'll tell you what, I'll get some other information that we'll have on hand here. They're rechanging the boards. This is done every morning about this time and oftentimes at night as well. We found in New York Stock Exchange trading there were 774 declines, 609 advances, 296 were unchanged. Our up volume and down volume figures erased themselves, as you saw just a moment ago. Now, we're going to be back with our look at the American Stock Exchange figures just by word of mouth in a moment after this message from U.S. Steel.
Not every school is this crowded, but we need more classrooms. At U.S. Steel, we're helping relieve our crowded schools. We're involved. In Burlington, New Jersey, we used our own low-cost panel system to put up a six-building campus in just 53 working days. Library, classrooms, labs, the works. We're helping relieve crowded schools. At United States Steel, we're involved.
We're back at the boardroom now, and we're going to take a look at what's happening with trading on the American Stock Exchange at the close yesterday. Now, please note that these are blanks with the exception of this one error. And I repeat, that was because we had difficulty with a cable being cut somewhere between here and New York yesterday, and many of our figures did not post. Apparently, they're working all right today, though, because they have done a complete wipeout, preparing to give you all the excitement of today's market action. Suffice it to say, in American trading yesterday, it was a close one, but declines here did outnumber advances. It was 457, 457 to, you'd write in here, 409, and we had 266 unchanged. We do not have the up volume and down volume figures. Our Quotron figures did not post, as you know, before. And let's see if I can recall. The American indexes, I believe, strangely enough, had closed up by 0.03. So it was quite a market day, and as you stay tuned here to the Stock Market Observer, you'll see these boards posting music. Apparently, they are repaired now, and we look forward to having you with us. Market Reprise has been brought to you this morning by the folks at U.S. Steel. We invite you to stay tuned now as we bring you trading highlights, activity, and some of the up-and-down stocks on the New York Stock Exchange with Sue Plumridge in a moment.
And good morning. I'm Susan Plumridge, and I'm going to give you the 10 most active and the 5 most up and the 5 most down on the New York Stock Exchange. At the top of the list, International Telephone and Telegraph closed at 51 and 3/8 yesterday and was down 1. Texaco closed at 31 and a quarter, down a half. Amerada Hess common stock closed at 44, down 4 and 7/8 for the day. Scott Paper Company closed at 16 and 3 quarters, up 1. And Great Atlantic Pacific, known as AMP, closed at 19 and 3 quarters, down 1 and a quarter. Newmont was unchanged for the day and closed at 26. United Aircraft closed at 30 and 3/8, up 5/8. American Hospital closed at 38 and 3 quarters, down 1. First National City Corporation closed at 40 and 3 quarters, down 1/8 for the day. Braniff Airlines common stock closed at 14 and 3 quarters, up 3 quarters for the day. Sunbeam Corporation closed at 27 and a half, down 1.5, and Natomas closed at 61, up 5 for the day. American Telephone and Telegraph closed at 42 and 3/8, rather, up 1/8, and Ford Motor Company closed at 69 and a quarter, up 1/8. Plessy Limited was 2 1/8 and was unchanged for the day. And now we pause for this very important message from Ozark Airlines.
Let's peek into a window. A window that looks into an airline computer. Ozark's computer. When you call Ozark Airlines, this amazing machine gives instant answers to your questions about flights, seat availability, connecting service. Then we key your name and reservation into its memory, and you become unforgettable. Sure, computerized reservations is a big airline service. Ozark is up there with the biggest.
And now the 5 most up on the New York Stock Exchange. Natomas was first on the most up list. It closed at 61, up 5 for the day, and percentage gain was 8.9%. Continental Corporation closed at 44, up 2 7/8 for the day, and percentage gain again was 7%. Bell & Howell closed at 45 and a quarter, up 2 5/8, percentage gain 6.2%. And CertainTeed Corporation closed at 44, up 2 1/4, and the gain of 5.4%. Skyline Corporation closed at 53 and a quarter, up 2 3/4, and percentage gain there was 5.4%. And now we go to the offs, the 5 most down on the New York Stock Exchange. And the top of the list is Amerada Hess common stock, closed at 44, down 4 7/8 for the day, and percentage loss was 10%. Amerada Hess preferred stock closed at 96.5, down 7.5 for the day, and percentage loss on Amerada Hess preferred was 7.2%. Zapata Nornes Corporation closed at 24.5, down 1 3/4, and percentage loss was 6.7%. And Sunbeam Corporation closed at 27.5, down 1.5, and percentage loss was 5.2%. Studebaker Worthington closed at 39, down 2, and percentage loss was 4.9%. And I just want to read you something on ITT. International Telephone and Telegraph led the big board's active roster, dropping 1 to 51 3/8 on turnover of 390,000 shares. Included was a block trade of 309,500 shares at 50 3/4, which was handled by Goldman Sachs and Company. It's understood the block was sold on behalf of a company acquired by ITT with institutions on the buy side. And now here is Ben Larson.
Introduce now yesterday, today, and tomorrow. The important reasons for the market activity and the statistics that we have just reviewed, the prospects for interesting developments as today's market action unfolds, and opinions on the future of the economy and the stock market. Stay tuned now as Lamson Brothers provides an interesting 15 minutes of market commentary. To moderate this morning's discussion, here's Jack Hosty.
Good morning. Welcome to Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow. On your left is Ray Elman from Lamson & Company, one of our Ernst Weil and very excellent registered representatives. And on your right is Bill Diener, a partner of Lamson Brothers, the sort of fellow who pays the check. He's the boss, as you put it. And we're going to get together for a little chat this morning on what happened in the market yesterday, what we look for today, and then what we look for down the road. We're chatting just before we started, Ray, that you thought you detected something unusual in the market yesterday, in that you thought speculation was returning a bit.
It appeared that you had some professional buying in there and issues which could be used for some quick movement here, and the play seems to be going more and more towards that way, especially after you've had a break in the market that's been as severe as we've had in as short a span as we've had. And although it didn't carry for any great length of time, at the close, we did seem to be leveling off somewhat, and it'll be interesting to see whether we can carry forward with that pattern into today.
It was an interesting day yesterday, as they're all interesting once you get into them. If I can turn to Bill now here for a moment, we were talking about what a severe break we've had up till now, Bill, and what you thought that effect on yesterday's market was.
Well, the market's down some 47 points in 10 trading days, or 40 points in 7 days. Yesterday's, the day before yesterday's action, had some of the heaviest volume seen in the last 3 months, and some sort of a leveling out process, sparked largely by trading favorites and traders, as I agree with Ray, was only natural yesterday. And the market sold off early in the morning and sort of dried up and refused to go down too much lower. If you were watching the tape, you could see buying coming in to trading favorites. So I guess Natomas would be as good a typical example as any, which all by itself and all by themselves, talking about others, seemed to pick things up. A little disappointing, however, that we weren't able to carry through toward the close and perhaps put the Dow and the advanced decline figures into the plus side.
Do you think that, again, going to your area of expertise, that these figures that we got on odd lots earlier this week continue to affect the market yesterday?
Do you mean odd lots, or do you mean the institutional?
I said odd lots, and I meant the mutual funds. When the mutual funds, the redemptions were much heavier than sales, that figure, I think, came out Monday or Tuesday night, and it's been kind of weighing the market ever since.
Institutional liquidity, in my opinion, is one of the major problems the market's going to have to contend with. Historically, since I've been reading about the figures, and I certainly haven't gone back and done individual research on it, but since I've been reading about it, it's been difficult for the market to mount a sustained advance with institutional liquidity, and the only index we have of that that really is readily available is the amount of cash in mutual fund hands, as low as it is. Yes, I do think this is a continuing problem. It also points up another factor that is a problem in this kind of a program in trying to pinpoint specific reasons for each day's market action. Each day is a part of a series of previous days. It's only when you have some sharp, dramatic news, such as President Johnson resigning or Nixon's various announcements lately, that you can probably...
Or cutting the prime that didn't do anything for us the day before.
You can point to that and say, hey, here's the reason the market did this. Buying decisions are made over a period of time and an accumulation of information, and somebody may be looking for a stock to buy starting a month ago and finally make their big decision today, and therefore trying to pinpoint what happened today, isolating it is very, very difficult.
Right, but yet, unfortunately, today is the market we have to live in.
Yes.
You can't live in yesterday's or down the pike. Turning again to Ray, when we were talking earlier, Ray, you said that you felt that the liquidity of the money supply had a certain bearing on this thing. I thought it came in.
There's been a correlation here between the growth in the money supply and your movement in the market. When we had the relatively rapid expansion in the money supply in the first several months of the year of roughly 10-11%, which was somewhat inordinate as far as expansions go, we did have a very booming market, as you can remember, in the first roughly 4 or 5 months of the year. Now that you've gone down to a relatively 2 to 3% or almost a zero growth, which I believe the figures that came out today indicated a slightly negative to zero growth, seems to always coincide with a market that's down. But one thought entered into my mind. With the market down and with the money supply having retrenched, could this be a spot where, with a sudden reversal by the Fed, and an expansion again in the money supply coming perhaps in the last 2 months of the year or somewhere along that line, we may possibly pick up somewhat in our activity and in the scope of the market based on that. So I think you will see some bargain hunting starting to come in and around the levels that we are at in the market right now. However, it appears that it's a market primarily for extremely nimble traders. And
isn't it always?
It always is, but even more so. Perhaps it's, I believe, between now and the end of the year, it will be a highlighted by the nimbleness of the even the mutual funds and some of the hedge funds, which will probably be doing more and more trading rather than perhaps actually positioning issues here going into the end of the year.
Fine. Let's get into that a little bit more after we switch into the today section of the program. In the meantime, I'd like to make a free offer to our listeners. Every year around this time, Lamson Brothers writes a tax letter, which we will be glad to send you free of charge. I wrote it, so I'm kind of proud of it, together with Chuck Doherty, so you have some expertise too. But in there, we discuss specifics on what you should do with your tax picture when you're coming towards the end of the year. Now, this is available to you if you'll just write Lamson Brothers, L-A-M-S-O-N Brothers, at 141-141 West Jackson, Chicago 60604. If on your envelope or on your card, you'll just write the word tax, T-A-X, we'll know what you want. Just send it in to 141 West Jackson, Chicago 60604, and we'll be glad to send you a complimentary copy of our tax letter.
Good morning. A quick look at today's headlines and the weather. President Nixon sends his two nominations to the U.S. Supreme Court to the Senate for confirmation today. Indications are that unless some startling information turns up, Assistant Attorney General William Rehnquist and Virginia Attorney Lewis Powell will win Senate confirmation. U.S. troops have begun to pull out of the last American border artillery base in Vietnam, involved as a withdrawal from Fire Base Pace, which has come under heavy communist artillery attack for more than a month. Three women were injured when five men touched off a blast in a Belfast, Northern Ireland egg packing plant. Renewed trouble in Memphis, Tennessee resulted in injuries to three persons. Three firebombs were tossed into a cocktail lounge patronized by whites. Earlier, a three-year-old black child was killed when struck by a police car. Another effort will be made today to get the stalemated soft cold strike talks back on the track. Negotiations are being moved from Washington to Charleston, West Virginia, in the hope bargaining can resume in earnest. Our forecast for today, well, you could almost say it's a foggy day in London town. Cloudy, chance of showers high in the mid-70s. A chance of showers and cooler, low in the upper 50s tonight. Tomorrow, cloudy, chance of showers high in the upper 60s. The probability of rain about 40% today, tonight, and tomorrow. The winds are variable, 6 to 12 miles an hour. The relative humidity, a very high 84%. The winds, non-existent, they're calm. It's 60 degrees in the loop, 64 at O'Hare. The official Chicago temperature at Midway Airport is 65 degrees. A quick look at the news and the weather. Now back to today, yesterday, today, and tomorrow with Jack Hosty.
We talked about what happened in yesterday's market, and we got down the pike just a little bit, but we wanted to talk about what we can expect for today's market, which is probably the toughest thing of all. Ray, we were talking just a moment ago during the news there that you thought we might have some effect from the news that came out yesterday. Would you go into that a little bit?
Well, with the drop in short interest and with the basic lack of any really additional news since the prime rate, although we did get a floating prime rate out of a couple of the New York banks, which will probably be beneficial in the longer run. But as far as a stimulative effect, it really won't cause any unusual reaction. I would look for a continued movement into some bargain hunting by some of the professional traders. I noticed at the close yesterday, and I think it'll carry in today, some of the mobile home stocks, which have been the relatively strongest group on the board, should continue moving in there. I'd like to see some movement coming in today into some of the retail-oriented stocks, because if we don't get any pickup in consumer buying, we really can't look for an overall expansion in many other industries. So some of this trading should take place in those areas.
I see. What do you look for today, Bill?
Well, normally I'm an argumentative kind of fellow, but this time I'm going to have to basically agree with Ray. There really isn't anything, any development in the news that would indicate a startling change one way or the other from what we've been having. After the kind of selling pressure that the market has gone through in the last 10 days, which has been heavy but not fantastically heavy, I think you've got a chance for some further recovery today. But without, and in spite of the lowering of the prime rate, which certainly psychologically has to be bullish, even though it may have represented a reflection of what actually was rather than some drastic new development. Without anything in the picture but that, I'm not sure that you're going to get the type of sharp recovery today, let's say, that would equal the 12-point decline we had in the market a couple of days ago. So if I had to make a wild guess, and forecasting, especially in the stock market, tends to be somewhat wild, I'd look for a relatively good opening, and after that, I honestly wouldn't know what to tell you.
Well, I think that we're going to see what you would call the Friday phenomena today, too, and that is Friday usually goes counter-trend to what's happened during the rest of the week. If you've had an up week, you tend to sell off on Friday. If you've had a down week, you tend to rally on a Friday. We all know that we've had a down week and a pretty deep down week. So I think all in all, we can say that the factors build up today, both the change in the short interest, the idea that the institutions seem to be bargain hunting in this market, that certain elements of the market have begun to take over the leadership here, that the Dow should move stronger, as Bill said, at least early in the period, and we'll have to see what happens for the rest of the day. Potentially, I think we have the potential of a good, strong market today. I think all three of us agree on that. And you just can't have to play it by ear after kind of noon. But I think if we had to put our money on it, we'd look for, what would you say, $2-3 up on the day if we had to go out on the limb?
I wouldn't say any more than that. I think that would be the upper range of any kind of an up move that you got today. I would say it could be more or less a day like yesterday, where even though we dropped down somewhat in the morning, we rallied back, we're up a slight amount, and at the end of the day was almost a neutral pattern there, because with these bargain hunting that's going on and with a certain amount of rather sharp in and out trading, at every level there are stocks available for sale, so that tends to arrest any kind of an up move. And on the downside, you've pretty much taken a lot of stocks down to a point where people are willing to commit funds to them, saying that, well, they have receded substantially and could be relatively reasonable buys at these levels. So you do have somewhat of a standoff at this particular point, barring some unforeseen news development, which on the horizon does, and there isn't really anything that appears now to really stimulate or kindle any unusually heavy trading action today.
No, I think the stuff is generally, the news is generally
pretty well
bullish,
been hashed out already. And
I think the Supreme Court appointments could help. Our faith in Dick Nixon has got an awful lot to do with
Well, the faith is the one thing the market's been lacking in general, and I think anything that can help to restore any iota of faith is always a plus factor.
Yeah, it looks like they're not going to hang them from the rafters for these particular appointments.
No, they look relatively good. And
which I think the less they do to hurt the president, the better the stock market's going to react.
Any slight factor here now is a plus factor.
Okay, now if we can say a word about the Nuveen Tax-Free Bond Fund. The Nuveen Tax-Free Bond Fund is a very unusual mutual fund. It is composed entirely of tax-free bonds. The interest on these securities flow tax-free directly to the holder. Since any mutual fund must be sold by prospectus only, we'd like you to write in to Lamson Brothers, L-A-M-S-O-N Brothers, at 141 West Jackson, Chicago 60604. We'll be glad to send you a free copy of the Nuveen Tax-Exempt Bond Fund Prospectus. If you just put Nuveen, N-U-V-E-E-N, N-U-V-E-E-N, on the envelope or card, we'll be glad to send you a free copy of the prospectus on the Nuveen Tax-Exempt Bond Fund. Again, that address is 141-141 West Jackson, Chicago 60604.
And now, some first financial headlines. Brokers say they look for a quiet day on Wall Street, which is usual before the weekend. The key slogan of the stock market remains phase two. Some news highlights at this hour. London gold, $42.00, 4.475 unchanged. Sterling firm in London. Spain cuts discount rate to 5% from 6%. London stock steady after early upturn. Dollar rises from floor on Paris commercial market. Paris paper says group of 10 agreed on average 10% revaluation against dollar. UAL Incorporated says third quarter results will be better than a year ago. Dollar at record low in Tokyo. Ramada unit plans hotels in Europe. Slates $12 million Eurobond issue. Mohawk Data Sciences, French unit increases capitalization. Dollar fixed higher in Frankfurt. And the firm of Abraham and Company says it still favors an aggressive approach to common stock investment as the industrials continue to fluctuate. That's a capsule of the morning's important business news. Now back to Jack Hosty with yesterday, today, and tomorrow.
Hello, back again. This is the segment we're going to talk about the easier part of the market, that is the long-term pull. I had a professor in college who said there was only one tough market, that's today's, tomorrow's is easy. We were talking during the news break with Bill Diener here, and he's had some thoughts on the long swing of the market. Bill, by the way, is an expert in this area. He writes a daily letter for our 22 branches that goes over our private wire system on a daily basis. So Bill is well grounded in the fundamentals of the long-term forecasting of the market. What do you say to the market here, Bill?
Well, of course, one of the joys about writing about the long term is that nobody can really pin you down as to where that is and where it begins and where it ends. As I mentioned earlier in the yesterday part, I feel that one of the major problems the market has to overcome is the lack of institutional liquidity. There is strong evidence in the redemption of mutual funds and in the odd lot figures that the public has been getting out of the market. And certainly the SEC long-range studies indicate that the individuals, the public, has been, on balance, a liquidator of securities. These have been mostly bought by institutions, pension funds, life insurance plan companies, profit-sharing plans, and mutual funds. And we do have some evidence that the amount of cash in the hands of the institutions is now at a relatively low figure. Furthermore, there are some questions is putting it mildly, as to just what does phase two mean to the future of, let's say, corporate profits, which are the basic thing that determine stock prices, and what's all happening on the international monetary front. The intermediate direction of this market lately has been down. There's probably no question about that. While I certainly am not a forecaster of gloom and doom and looking for a major sell-off from here, I don't see much in the picture to alleviate this uncertainty, to clear up some of these really very important questions that would lead me to forecast, let's say, a sharp rise in stock prices over the intermediate term, which would be the next 2 to 3 months. A bull market always begins in a climate of doubt and uncertainty. We sure have that now. I do, however, feel that we need to clear up some of these questions a little further before you can look with confidence and say, yeah, I really think the next 2 to 3 months are going to be terrific. If you wanted a direct answer, I would say not a lot of action, and perhaps the general averages would fluctuate in this area, maybe a little lower. But on an individual stock basis, as has happened all year, we're going to get some spectacular movement.
In other words, you think that if you pick the right stocks, that this could be the time to be buying those.